not gonna conform to your mindset or what you want me to be or what they want me to be. I'm gonna do what my father orders me to do.
Hebrew is a Semitic language. Not Semitic, but Shemitic. And proof that the modern Hebrew has been Hellenized is why they pronounce sounds like Semitic. They use the sound like Semitic because there's no SH sound in the Greek. So they say you're Semitic. Understand that. In our mother tongue, it would have been Shemitic, coming from Shem. Thumbs up as you come in the room. Just be quiet, hold your horses, and you just might learn something. In fact, I'm certain you will learn something. You'll be astonished by what you thought you knew, because this message is being brought to you through the Ruach HaKadosh. So Hebrew is a Shemitic language. And so some people refer to as one of the Afro-Asiatics family, which is also a misnomer. Does any of you guys know what that continent was called prior to it being called Africa?
Khan.
Now you got Khan Benaiah on here. The man said he wanted to be a priest 3-4 years ago. I know he's a priest by now. Khan. Yes. What was it called prior to that?
Kemet.
How many of you guys agree with that? Was it called Kemet?
I say the land of Ham.
Well, that's some English transliteration. So we know it wasn't that. And Ham, that Ham would have actually been pronounced Ham. So, what would you say, Khan? Benaiah?
I don't think I'm there yet. I'm not sure about that one.
Well, it wasn't Kemet, it wasn't the land of Ham. It was actually called a Kabbalah. Kabbalah. According to experts that researched it, prior to the invasion, in the original name, it was referred to as a Kabbalah. Now they call it African. The word a Kabbalah, when you look it up, it means the mother of mankind, or according to other sources, the Garden of Eden. Now that's interesting. The Garden of Eden. See, a Kabbalah, when I looked it up, it was an extremely old word. So its origin was indigenous. So there's a lot of nations in what they call modern day Africa, including the ones that they refer to as Ethiopians, Nubians, Moors, that would use that word. The name Africa, as we know it, was given to the continent by who? The Greco-Romans. Modern Hebrew, they refer to it as Ivrit. So JD speaks. It's what Moshe speaks. It's what you hear me speaking sometime. Now, I know it's not the ancient Hebrew. It's not primary Hebrew. It's not. And it's been so mixed. It's so much of an admixture. It suffice to say it's not real Hebrew at all. See, when Yahuwah wrote the Ten Commandments to Moses, with his finger, he wrote that in the Paleo Hebrew. He didn't write this modern Hebrew that you hear Moshe and JD and me speaking sometime. That's No, that's not what Yahuwah wrote in. That came out of Babylon. Modern Hebrew literally has its root in ancient Paleo Hebrew, right? But Yahuwah did not write the Ten Commandments in this modern Babylonian script. When he gave the Ten Commandments to Moshe, he didn't write it in that. That Babylonian script, this square script that you see in modern day, that's not our mother. That didn't come from our mother tongue. They took up a lot of the Babylonian characters and emulated them. But that's what people refer to as modern Hebrew. He said, "Tell the doc, why do I hear you speaking?" Well, speak it to study them, to understand what they're trying to say. But it's not primary Hebrew. See, Paleo Hebrew, which the Israelite communities around the world have used for prayers and for study for centuries. Now, as a spoken language, the ancient Hebrew was most wisely used in the kingdom of Israel and in the kingdom of Judah. Huh? This was during the 10th all the way down to the 7th century BCE. Now, spoken Hebrew literally declined in ancient times after the Babylonian captivity. Now, remember, and I'll go into more history and exact dates a little later. Remember, the tribe of Judah went into captivity. It was overthrown by Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonians. They came out speaking a different language. And I'm going to go into why all of that happened. And I would highly encourage you to sit down with your family to really listen to this, because I'm going to drop some real gems tonight. I want JD on it. So when this modern day Hebrew came from the Babylonian captivity, spoken Hebrew declined in ancient times after that Babylonian exile of the Israelite people. So in real truth, it became practically extinct as a spoken language. So now, when you fast forward to the late antiquity, I'm talking around the 8th century now, CE, the Paleo Hebrew was replaced with Aramaic. That's what they refer to as modern Hebrew, Aramaic. And Aramaic was essentially a regional language used for trade. Now, watch this. A lot of the Greeks spoke Aramaic as well. Why? Because it was the language of the ruling class. So a lot of Greeks picked it up. Now, does anyone know who Bar Kahaba is? Bar Kahaba? There was something known as the Bar Kahaba revolt against the Romans that took place around 132 to 136 AD. Now, most of the Israelite population was literally exiled. And so they adapted to the societies that they live in, just like right now. Most of our people don't speak the Ibrit, but they speak English, they speak Spanish, they speak French. S'entendez-vous? Come on. Yeah, they speak not in their mother tongue. Sounds funny, but it's real, huh? Come on. They're speaking in the local language, in other words. So that's what happened to us during the exile. we started adapting the languages into a dialect of our own. This is how the language got all messed up. Now, bar chut taba, bar chukba is Aramir. That literally means son of the star. Bar chukba literally died around 130 CE. That's the same time Esau started getting busy. In Palestine, on the West Bank. Now, you do the history, and you read it in Kahan Tazadok's Doc's books, you see around 135 BCE, there was a large integration of Amalekites into our way of life, 135 CE. A lot of them still following our way of life. Herod was an Edomite. They referred to him as Jewish. He was an Edomite. He was a descendant of Amalek. He was an Agagite. So now at this time, what happens when people read history, there's not really good historians. They're mistaking a lot of these Agagites and Amalekites for Yahshua. Herod was Jewish. Herod practiced a religion known as Judaism. So, what I'm talking about, Bar Chaba, he was a Jewish leader who led a battle that was actually unsuccessful. He led a revolt from 132 to about 135 CE against the Romans in Judea. Now, during his tour of the Eastern Empire, which was around 131, the Roman Emperor Hadrian decided upon a policy of Hellenization. You guys know what Hellenization is, right? No, you guys heard me say that before. It's Hellenization.
Being assimilated into the...
It's the Greeks. When something is Hellenized, the Greeks has been involved. The Greeks has influence on it. So this is what happened. This is why people say things like, oh, he's anti-Semitic. Instead of saying Shemitic, they've been Hellenized. They've been Hellenized. But why? Because as I said at the inception, there's no SH sound in Greek, in the Greek alphabet. So they can't say Shem. They say Semitic. A lot of them don't know this history. So it would be good for them to watch as well. Because a lot of them are not allowed to read. Not certain things. Some of them are not even allowed to have cell phones. So it would be a good idea to watch this. Then go and check it out for yourselves. Even if you have to check it out in the closet. So, many was Hellenized to integrate the Jews at that time. Remember, Esau's mixed in here now, into that empire. What happened? They started getting circumcised. Amalekites started getting circumcised. There was a Roman colony that was found in Jerusalem, and a temple to Jupiter was erected over the ruins of our temple once it got destroyed. They built a paganistic temple to worship Jupiter right over our temple. So what happened, many of the Yahudim became enraged. And so a year later, in 132, they revolted. There was a man that was considered to be a dominant figure, and he led a revolt. The man's name was Simeon Bar Kozba. He was at the head of that revolt. Then there was also Akiva Ben Yosef, who also gave him the title Bar Kochba, son of the star, which is really a messianic allusion. Bar Kochba, he took the title Nasi. What does that mean? What is Nasi? So where Nasi means Israelite scholars, Hebrew scholars, or Nasi means prince. So 135, Bar Kochba was killed at a stronghold that was southwest of Jerusalem. And so the remnant of the Jewish army was crushed. There was all sorts of Jewish war, Jewish emphasis added, casualties. They said it was over 580,000 Jewish casualties, not including those that died of hunger and diseases. What happened? Judea was desolate. The remnant of the Jewish population was annihilated or exiled. Now you got some of Yasha Allah in there, but Esau was in it also. That's when they first converted in 135 BCE under John Hyrcanus. Then you got another faction of them that converted in 540 AD in Khazaria. I don't want to go into that. I would like to keep this up. Now, let's get back to the language. Just giving you a little history on him since no one knew who he was. Let's get back to the language. So, Yiddish and Latin are perfect examples of how there was many different dialects developed. See, the Israelite people continue to use classical or ancient Paleo Hebrew in written form for a lot of things, like letters, documents, poetry, the written laws, right? But around 200 CE, the Israelite people began to use vowels. They brought the vowels in. Nakut. They call it Nakut. Huh? See all them dots and stuff that you see in what they refer to as modern Hebrew that came out of Babylon? That's called Nakut. This took place around 200 CE when they began to use these vowels. They claim it was to make it more accessible and to keep it consistent from generation to generation. So what they did, they got in there, you know, it's been Romanized, so you get what is known as the Masoretic text. This is what it looked like, but when we go back to the old Hebrew, you see that the Nash Papyrus, we don't see the Makud or anything in there. They changed the words around. So when we go back to the first millennium BCE, transmitting any sort of document from generation to generation, there's been alterations, some intentional, others not intentional. So they've changed our language around. So once they got in the book,
things begin to be altered. So, you know, there's a lot of indoctrination into it. Just about any book, it contains textual difficulties, corruptions, and even mistakes from the original Hebrew text. Understand that. Right, here's a page from the Aleppo Codex, right, of the Masoretic text. This page comes from the Aleppo Codex. So until a third of it was actually literally burned in 1947 in an anti-Jewish uprising in Syria. When we look at the original Hebrew Bible, we see that there are no vowels, just consonants. It had no vowel sounds. It was only consonants. Therefore, Yahuwah called on us to memorize, right? So we had to memorize it. But around the 10th century, when Jewish people, the scribes known as Masoretes, began to write down many of these things, the Masoretes added the Nakuda to our original Paleo Hebrew. So they added the vowels, and it literally changed the pronunciation of the words. So you have the Masoretes to thank for that. But the original Paleo Hebrew had no vowels. And so today you have people like this guy, this vocab Malone, saying that's not really Hebrew because they don't really understand our ancient language. It was not given to them. Do you understand? Do you understand?
Now, there was a lot of different groups of Israelites that began to use this type of system. And one that continued to use it came from
the Masoretes. The Masoretes were Romanized.
That means Romanized. They got Romanized. Masters of tradition. So these Jewish scribes and scholars that worked all the way up to the end of the 5th, from the 5th to about the 10th century CE, they begin to base their writings into this new form of Hebrew. They begin to speak this new form of Hebrew. Now, then, somewhere around the end, towards the end of the 19th century, the Zionist movement took place. Everybody know what the Zionist movement is, right? We're at the 9th century now, but fast forward into modern day. What is the Zionist movement? Ain't nobody saying nothing, boy, man. Ooh-wee. I gotta go and get Brother Nefertali, man. What is the Zionist movement, man? Ooh-wee. Zionist movement. Come on, Kahan. But not, what's the Zionist movement, man?
Isn't it like...
Started around the 19th century. The Zionist movement began.
I know what a Zionist is. Someone who believes, like, they're, there's solely like no other nation of people should even be, you know, around them or on their level. It's like summary. So I guess the Zionist movement is just they're by themselves. They're on a different level. All the other nations are what do they say, goy.
Well, Kadar Yashi Beam's quiet tonight, boy. He quiet tonight, man. He usually got something to say, man. He quiet tonight. Get here, pin drop. Come on. Well, the Zionist movement is essentially, it began, meaning that the Jews that had actually dispersed started returning to Israel, or so they say. So they say. Huh? They call that the Zionist movement when they started going to Israel. They like to use the word return. I like to use the word they started going there. Huh? That was part of the Ottoman Empire. If you guys remember, I was telling JD last night about the Arabs. they're not ancient to that land. That the original Arabs were Ishmaelites that came from an African woman, Hagar, and a melanated so-called black Israelite man by the name of Abraham. Yeah. So nevertheless, when these people started returning, as they say, I said they started going to the ancient land of Israel. That was then part of the Ottoman Empire at that time that they started going there. So they started contributing to the reconstruction of the Hebrew language. This movement emerged beginning in the 19th century. So what happened, it enabled a particular people to establish their homeland in what is referred to as Israel today. Huh? Now keep in mind, by this time, the Amalekite had already infiltrated. So you had now, notice I'll start using the term Jewish. So at this time, by this time, you had a, you know, certain groups of Jewish people who were attempting to revive the language. So they tried to revive it in different ways. They started using Hebrew newspapers. They was using that as a vehicle to try and get this language to others. They was using it in non-religious texts. So I'm getting feedback from someone there. They was using it in non-religious texts. Now, there was a man by the name of Eliezer Ben Yehuda. Now, this man was most notably known for what you call this modern-day Hebrew. Because even though it had been passed down over the years, there was all sorts of different dialects. So one of the most famous people that helped push this modern day Hebrew and says Hebrew was Eliezer Ben Yehuda. Now this man, he was working extremely hard to revive what they refer to as Hebrew today, as we know it today, as a spoken language, because it had became a dead language. So what Ben Yehuda was doing, he'd seen other nationalities like the Bulgarians receive the state of their own. And meanwhile, keep in mind, Jewish people didn't have no state at this time. So what did he do? He began working towards a state and a unified language for Jewish people. Emphasis on that. Just telling history ain't no reason for nobody to get head up. You can go and check it for yourself. Don't check your temperature. I'm just telling history, man. Go and check it out for yourself, man. So, meanwhile, the Jewish people didn't have a state. So, he wanted them to have a state of their own and a language of their own. Ben Yehuda, I got his dictionary. Eliezer Ben Yehuda. Ben Yehuda began to speak Hebrew in his home with all Jewish, emphasis added, people he came in contact with. See, watch this. What Ben Yehuda did is he filled in the need of the modern words such as ice cream by coining them himself. So this is what I'm telling JD. Now, a lot of the stuff that they're speaking is not Hebrew, man. Which is why it sounds so awkward. Ben Yehuda coined a lot of these words himself. And so the next step that he done was to bring the Hebrew into schools. Why? Because the young people in their schools were from different language backgrounds. They wasn't able to speak together with each other. So Ben Yehuda came with a common language that they all could speak. He called it Hebrew. They call it Hebrew. If you don't speak it,
Eliezer Ben Yehuda is responsible for creating what is referred to as modern Hebrew. It is not biblical Hebrew. It is a conglomerate of many different dialects. It is not the modern biblical Hebrew. And so when I tell people that, they become offended, but I have to tell you the truth. I'm coming on and tell the doc, a real historian. And I just teach the truth, and the truth will make you mad. But if you can rise above your anger, it will make you free. It is the combination of many different dialects and languages. So he created a modern language that he calls Hebrew and make people think that they're speaking Hebrew, but it's really not. Atami vini vri. Lo. At my vina ivri. Ken. Animi vini vri. Told me of. Atamerba. Angri? Ken. Animivin Angli told me up.
So Ben, like, he started spreading it like that. Do you speak Hebrew? Yeah, I speak a little Hebrew. No, you don't speak any? I speak a little Hebrew. Come on.
A little is Sut. Sut.
Sut.
Sut.
So, anime vin sa ivri. Anime vin ivri told me, oh, I speak Hebrew very well. So, nevertheless, Ben Yehuda, he started coining his own words because they all spoke a different dialect and they got all different kind of languages now. So he started coining different words. Why? He wanted the people to be familiar with what he was referring to as Hebrew in everyday context. So Ben Yehuda needed a vehicle so he could actually publish articles. And what he was referring to as, and by the way, people has actually literally accepted this as Hebrew. And since we don't know any better, we don't do our research. Hey, it's Hebrew. They say it's Hebrew. It says Hebrew. You know, when we speak the paleo, and we're like, oh, man, that's not Hebrew. This stuff don't have no vowels. Well, it didn't have any in the beginning. Yahuwah didn't use no vowels. When he wrote those four letters with his fingers, they translated in Latin. They call it the YHWH. But it's Yuhayahe. Huh? But they translated over into Latin. They put a W there that doesn't even belong there. And I'll go into that. I've probably already been speaking for a minute, man. So Ben Yehuda needed a vehicle, man. So what he started doing was publishing articles in Hebrew in the local newspaper. And so that was his vehicle for attempting to, they claim he's reviving Hebrew. It wasn't even the same anymore. But they say he revived Hebrew. And that was throughout the last half of the 19th century. And he was very successful with it. Because now you got people speaking it all throughout Israel, even overhead. You heard JD speaking. You heard Moshe speaking. You just heard me speaking. So by the end of the 1800s, almost every male Jewish man living in Palestine could read and understand what they referred to as Hebrew. which I refer to as modern day Hebrew, which is Aramaic. Why? Because it was put in every newspaper. See, somewhere else they would call that propaganda. Now, to aid those people in learning that, guess what he did? He compiled a dictionary. And he published new words. He created his own words.
Yo, you can't make this up. That's facts.
This is what you guys are learning. This is what you guys are enunciating. I got his dictionary. I got a couple of them in the room. So he published the dictionary. He compiled all these new words in a dictionary and he published them, these new words, in the newspaper. So now this man's creating words like he's Webster, you dig? But he did it with what they're referring to as Martin. I'm just telling you, man, this is how it went. You guys can go and check it out for yourself, man. Go and check it out for yourself. So he published these new words because he wanted his people to be able to fulfill the gaps of the modern Hebrew that it was still lacking. Because like I said, it had became a dead language. And so the last contributing factor to the success of Ben Yahudi's mission at that particular time, he had Jewish people from all over the world coming to Israel. See, when they tell the story, they say returning. I say coming. And so I challenge any rabbi, I challenge JD, I challenge any scholar, prove me wrong. When those people went to Israel, they were speaking all sorts of different languages. That's why Ben Yahudi created the language that he created and called it Hebrew. So what he did, he used some of the ancient Hebrew, and he mixed it in with all kinds of different languages. The Greek, there's some Greek in there. That's why the word Shemite comes from. That's why you got words like Genesis in the Bible, Exodus. Those are Greek words, man. See, many of these people that went to Israel were Zionists. Eliezer Ben Yehuda himself was a Zionist. And so they was eager to use the language. And so they call it Hebrew, and now everyone accepts it as Hebrew. See, they needed a common language in which to converse. So they compiled this language, and they call it Hebrew. There was a lot of people that was opposed to that idea. The ones that was orthodox and extremely religious was opposed to it. The Orthodox Jewish people didn't think that Hebrew should be used to discuss everyday things. They said it was a holy language, Kadosh. I'm going to hit you something. Oh, hey, were you guys with me? Where was I at? Well, I was in the hotel night. The Jewish guy walked in that night. See, I understand why he said what he said. He said, I don't speak Hebrew, I speak Yiddish. I understood right away what he was saying. So basically what he was telling me is that language is too sacred for me to speak. So he'll talk to me in Yiddish. So he said, I don't speak Hebrew, I speak Yiddish. So the reason that they say that is because they believe that the language is too sacred for a Goyim to be speaking. And so to this day, now stop me where I'm lying at, there's a lot of Jews in Israel who speak Yiddish instead of Hebrew for everyday matters. They won't speak it for everyday matters. So what happened is what they now call Hebrew or modern Hebrew, it became the official language of Palestine. in 1922. Stop me where I'm lying. I bet you all didn't know a lot of Palestinians spoke Hebrew. The other two languages, the English and the Arabic. So in 1948, it became the official language of this newly declared state of Israel.
So this offends the Palestinians, because many of the Palestinians are Muslims, and they say Al-Fatiha, Surah Al-Fatiha, five times a day. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin, Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in, Ihdina sirata mustaqim, sirata lazina am'amta alayhim ghayril maghdubi alayhim waladdallin.
It's the mostly widest spoken language in what they call as Israel today. I'm gonna hit you with something. This modern Hebrew, JD, because I know you're going to watch this, JD. Modern Hebrew is essentially complied of Shemitic vocabulary of classical Hebrew. It has a similar written appearance, but it's European phonology. Is literally European phonology. And it borrows many words from English and other languages. Now stop me where I'm lying at. I dare any rabbi to try and prove me wrong. I done looked at the language. So today, there's all sorts of different dialects of what they call Hebrew. You got the Sephardic, Ashkenazi Hebrew. See, Sephardic Hebrew originated with the Yahudim who dispersed to Spain. That's now spoken mostly by Jewish, emphasis on that, people who were most recently located in what they refer to as the Middle East and Africa. There's no such thing as the Middle East. Ashkenazi Hebrew is spoken by Jews who's mostly of Europe and places like New York and North America. But I'm interested, the pronunciation of the modern Hebrew is based on the Sephardic Hebrew. So the original Hebrew, man, came from us. Came from what they now refer to as the area of Israel. But there were several times throughout history that Hebrew was not spoken there. When the Israelites spent many years in exile, and later during the period of the diaspora, Hebrew wasn't spoken there. So it went through many changes. And this is why it sounds as it sounds today. See, culturally, Hebrew was referred to as the language of the Israelites. Modern Hebrew is the official language of over there in the land of Israel today. So it's spoken by several million people today that's living in Israel. Now both, I'm interested, both the Jewish and the non-Jewish people speak it. It's not primary Hebrew. I know they don't like it, but it's not primary Hebrew. And so in doing so, they concealed the true name of the Father. And that's what I want to get to, man. That's what I want to get to. What is his name? What is his son's name? See, a restoration is taking place today, man. Yasha Allah is waking up.